Hey, thanks for checking out our innovation podcast. Hopefully this gives you some encouragement for the rest of your week.
So hey, if you got a Bible with you this morning, we're going to be in Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3, if you don't have a Bible, that's no big deal. We will have the words up on the screen. Normally, we would put them on your note sheet that you got when you came in, but there's just a lot of verses there, so I didn't feel like typing them all out. Okay, let's just be honest, but they'll be up on the screen for you, and they're there for you to reference them. But we're starting a new series today called Moodswingers, And now, here's what I love about this series is that we are trying to take, for the next few weeks, an intentional approach to our moods and attitudes. I don't know how it works for you, but there's been plenty of times in my life when I will react to something or do something out of my base emotion and almost immediately regret it, right? This typically works out in my marriage. I will say something as a response, or I will give a look as a response that I know immediately was wrong, right? But a lot of times I can't even help myself. It's like I can't stop myself because our attitudes can just be overwhelming. So what we want to do in this series is we want to take a few weeks to look at how we can have some God-informed attitudes and moods that we can cultivate. And so we're going to talk about things like being grateful. Today we're going to talk about being confident, because I think for our culture, if we can be honest, we are about as ho-hum and down on things as we could possibly be. In fact, for us, I think our currency relationally now is we have to be outraged about everything. Well, the truth is this, man, outrage is an action. We want to have action in our life, and action, this spiritual thing we need to cultivate in our life, is confidence. So we're going to get into that in just a minute. But before we do that, I would love to pray for us. And here's why we pray. It's because every week we believe when we open up the scriptures, we're not just getting a transfer of information. This isn't a classroom, right? My goal is not to sit here and say, well, I'm the expert and you have something to learn, so take some notes and memorize it, because that's what we want. We believe every time we open this book that life transformation happens, whether it's in front of a group of people or by yourself in your house, your apartment, if you're in a classroom or you're just sitting on a bench somewhere, because maybe that's just the way you roll, you like being outside. But whenever you open this book, we believe that God is transforming your life, that this book is breathing, it's living, it's active, that nothing in here is a mistake, that God wants to speak to us through it. And so we pray simply to say, okay, God, help us to hear you more clearly and see you more clearly. Help us to walk out of here better than we came in, not because of our own effort, but because of his word, okay? So will you join me in prayer? Jesus, we thank you for how good you are. God, you have been better to us than many of us realize and than all of us deserve. God, help us this morning to be changed by your word, to take what you've written, what you've inspired people to write, and let it speak to our lives where we are now, even thousands of years separated from its original audience and original writers. God, let us really walk out of here stronger than we came in, more confident than when we came in. God, help us to be closer to you because of our time together. And God, we pray that the Cavs would sweep the Pacers and that the Indians would start doing a little better. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praying for everything can't hurt, right? Like, what's the worst thing that happens if you pray for your sports team? So I grew up, speaking of sports, loving basketball. Basketball is probably still my favorite sport. I love to play basketball. I love to watch basketball. Let's be honest, I do a lot more watching than playing now. But I love basketball. Growing up, I was a huge fan of Michael Jordan. I had the windbreaker that had the jump man on the back. In fact, my parents still have it in the closet. I don't know if I'm going to give it to my son when he's old enough, because he might ruin it, right? But I want to, but I don't want to. But I was a huge Michael Jordan fan, and so I would go out, and you imitate Michael Jordan when you play ball, right? Like, you stick your tongue out when you take a shot. You would try to like do the side to side layup, all of a sudden trick people. But when you're a white kid and you're like 4 foot nothing, it's a little more difficult to do those things, because you notice every little kid doesn't shoot like him. They do like the sideways shot where they just heave it up there. That's what I would do all the time. But I would go out, I'd wear my wristbands. Let's just be honest, that's the way you play. I would wear my wristbands. I still don't really know what wristbands do in basketball. I honestly have no clue. They just look cool, right? You make sure you have the Nike logo. I would still wipe the sweat off with my hands, so I was not using them right, but they looked really cool. You'd get the high socks on, right? Except I've always had these big, thick legs, and so everybody else, they would go all the way up to their knee. Mine would stop around like halfway up my calf, so they look like the old man socks that like when my uncle would play basketball. You're like, oh, cool, you dressed like a 40-year-old. But I loved basketball. But I remember in basketball, one memory that has stuck with me that's honestly not so fun. I remember growing up all through grade school, I was like a really skinny kid. Believe it or not, I really was. I promise you, there's an inner skinny kid in here somewhere. But that kid found Lay's potato chips, okay? And so I remember, I grew up playing basketball, playing in competitive leagues. I'd play in select leagues you had to try out for. We'd travel, do all that stuff. Well, I decided sixth grade, I was going to play in the community. Honestly, I just wanted to be one of the better players in the league, right? I was mediocre everywhere else. I was one of the best kids in this league. And so I went to play, and I remember I was at practice. And when you're at practice, you don't want to get confused. So you play shirts and skins, right? Girls, you didn't do this in basketball. That would be a felony. But we did. We'd play shirts and skins. And so I would be skins a lot because, let's be honest, any chance to, like, take clothes off in public, you're going to run for it. And so I would be skins. Now, I remember, though, after playing some pickup and scrimmaging together, we would have to do these wind sprints, and I hated sprints. And I remember I was doing this sprint, and my former basketball coach comes in the room, and he looks at me. I'm like kind of down on the ground, kind of leaning over, breathing real heavy, and I had put on some weight that summer. And he looks at me, and what he says to me with about as much disgust as I can remember was, "What happened to you, Johnson?" And I remember as a kid, no joke, that was the first time that I felt self-conscious about my looks. That was the first time that I felt bad about having my shirt off. That was the first time that I felt a lack of confidence with my appearance. I'd never felt that before. Here's what I'll tell you. That was really the start of a lack of confidence I had for years where, you know, we would have shirts and skins in basketball. I would try to be shirts from then on out. I just felt better about myself. When I go to sleepovers, you go to pool parties, your whole approach changes, right? Because you don't feel good about yourself. I had a lack of confidence for years that started out of an experience I had with something that I loved. And here's what I know for us. Maybe for you, it's not walking around with your shirt off, but it's something else. Maybe you have an ex in your life, whether it's a boyfriend, girlfriend, ex-husband, ex-wife, that they just did a number on your confidence, right? And you just walk around now going, man, I don't even know what I can do. Maybe you had a job one time where your former job, you were just thriving, you were doing really well, and then you got your new job and you just can't do anything right. Your boss doesn't commend you, nothing works for you, and your confidence is shot. Maybe you thought everything was going really well in your marriage, and then you had a kid, and that kid just changed everything for you, and you're going, I don't even know if I'm a good husband, if I'm a good wife, I don't even know if I'm going to be a good parent. Maybe you've struggled in some area of your life, maybe some private thing that you've got going on, and you just feel like, man, I can't get it right, and your confidence level is just low, and you walk around feeling completely not confident. You feel like you can't be successful, and you feel like things just aren't going to work out for you. I think this is the way a lot of us, if we're honest, if we take away the mask, take away the facade, I think most of us feel that way at some point in our lives, whether it's for a season or maybe it's something that you feel really consistently. Now, here's what I'll tell you, is when you feel a lack of confidence, there's really two responses you can have to that. One of them is very much culturally informed. The other one, I think, is more biblically informed. What culture is going to do is culture is going to tell you that you need to build up your self-confidence if you're not feeling confident, right? So what happens? You get broken up with. Somebody breaks up with you. I've never been dumped, but for those of you who have, right, you get dumped, and what do? You hit the gym. You get a haircut. After you eat ice cream for 3 weeks. You get a haircut, you try to look fresh because you want to bounce back, right? You're doing what you can to build up your self-confidence. Guys, you do the same thing. Like, you'll start shaving. You might actually start wearing clothes that have zippers now instead of just sweatpants all the time. You step up your game because you want to feel confident again. Whatever it is, culture is going to tell you, build up your self-confidence. But here's, I think, the better response, and the response we're going to talk about this morning, is I really believe that confidence, a lack of it, is not just an emotional problem, it's not just a physical problem. I think a lack of confidence is a spiritual problem. And here's why. Because if our confidence is in the right place, it should never be lacking. Here's what I mean. Our confidence is not meant to be in ourselves. Our confidence is meant to be in God. In fact, notice it's on your note sheet there. Paul writes this in 1 Corinthians 10. This is in the Message paraphrase. He says this. He says, forget about self-confidence. It's useless. It's useless. Cultivate God-confidence. Forget about self-confidence. It's useless. Cultivate God confidence. So here's the question we want to wrestle with this morning. The question we're going to spend about the next 10, 15 minutes or so wrestling with is this, is how do we build up our confidence in God? Right? Because we have ideas on how to build up our confidence in ourselves. If I told you, hey, you need to be more confident about yourself, you might be able to think of one or two or three things. But when it comes to building up your confidence with God, I think most of us really don't know. And so to do that, I want to look at Daniel chapter 3 in a story that if you grew up in church is actually very famous. If you watched VeggieTales, you know this story. It's the story in VeggieTales of Rakshak and Benny. True story. I've never seen a whole thing of VeggieTales before in my life. It's never, ever happened. I was a little too old. I just now have a kid that's not watching it, and I don't really hang out with your kids, so I have never seen one. But Rakshak and Benny, these guys, their real names were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So I want to give you a little bit of background before we get into it. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were not born with those names. In fact, they were born with very different names, but at some point in their life, they were taken to Babylon in exile. This meant that they were taken from their home by force, and they were forced to live in a culture that was not their own. They were given new names, given new things to learn. They were supposed to immerse themselves in this culture because the goal was for them to be nothing like their old self. They wanted to completely replace who these men were. And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're in this situation, and here's their tension point, is they're being told what they need to be, but in their heart, they still want to serve God. Now, here's why that's a problem, is because in Babylonian culture, the king was basically God. The king could create gods. He could make idols that you were told you had to worship. And so all of a sudden, you've got a king who's got all these different rules, and his rules don't line up with what their true king, God, says they should do. And this really comes to a head one day when Nebuchadnezzar has some people take some gold, and they make a new idol out of it. And the rule is that whenever you're in this kingdom and you hear all these different instruments begin to play, you are meant to bow down and worship this idol that Nebuchadnezzar had created. Now, this is a problem for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego because they're told in the Ten Commandments that thou shalt have no other gods before me. So they won't bow their knee to a false god because their knee is reserved for the one true God. So some people catch wind of this, some astrologers catch wind of this, and they go to King Nebuchadnezzar and they let him know what's happening. And the king gets heated. He gets mad right away. And so he calls for these three men to come in, and we're going to jump in here, Daniel chapter 3 in verse 14 there in the second half of the verse. The king speaking to these three men in his chambers, he says, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold I have set up?" It's a hype. He's not asking, like, do you really not do this? He's letting them know, I know you're not doing what I've told you to do. He says, "Now when you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music," as if he didn't list enough instruments already. Let's just throw them all out there. "If you are ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Then," notice this question, "then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand?" That question really tells us what Nebuchadnezzar thinks. Nebuchadnezzar's way of thinking, his way of belief, is that he is the supreme being in this situation. His way of thinking is, nothing can rescue you from what I want to do to you. I'm in control and I'm in charge. Because once again, remember how he thinks. He is God on earth at this point. No one is more powerful than him. So what God will rescue you three from what I want to do to you? And notice the confidence of response that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego give. They replied to him, verse 16, saying, "King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter." In other words, we're not even going to argue about this. We don't need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it, and he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up. See, they make it clear with every bit of confidence they can muster up. And notice, this doesn't seem forced. This doesn't seem faked. This isn't false bravado. This is truthfully what they believe. They say, our God can rescue us, and he will surely rescue us from your hand. In other words, king, you're not as in charge as you think you are. We serve a God that's bigger than you, and we will not worship you. But even if he does not serve, even if he does not help us, we are willing to die believing in him and trusting in him. We'd rather do that than live and believing and trusting in you. They put their foot down, every bit of confidence. Notice their confidence is not in themselves. Right, a lot of us, when we get in that situation, what culture would tell us is, man, you need to be confident in yourself and try and like work it out. Like these guys, if they were confident in themselves, they would have been like, hey, king, we're going to punch you now. And you're just going to deal with it because I'm stronger than you and I can beat you up. But that's not what they say. They say, we believe God can deliver us and that he will deliver us. They're confident, not in themselves, but they're confident in God. Now notice what happens. This is not where the story gets better. In fact, this account gets much, much worse. It says, then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and his attitude toward them changed. In other words, he was giving them the benefit of the doubt before, but he would do so no longer. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. In other words, the furnace was going to kill you and now it's going to like super duper kill you, okay? It's going to be even hotter and our strongest men are going to tie you up because I'm so mad I want to make a statement. I'm going to make this as brutal as I can. So these men wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, which I'm never quite sure why we need to know everything they're wearing, right? This isn't the red carpet. You're just throwing men in fire, but whatever. Were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command, notice, was so urgent and the furnace so hot that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these 3 men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. This fire, because in his haste, he wants to make it so much hotter, so much faster, it kills the men whose job is to kill these 3 men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's intense, right? Like you think about that. If you've ever been around a bonfire that got out of control before, maybe you singed your eyebrows before because you like to play with the lighter fluid, right? That's not how you really build a fire, but some people do it that way. It's hot. And it's so hot for these men that they actually die. But notice verse 24. It says, then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, weren't there 3 men that we tied up and threw into the fire? And they replied, certainly, your master. In other words, he's thinking, we didn't just throw another guy in there, right? Like, we didn't make a mistake. Like, let's check the books. We don't want to kill people for no reason. But they say, no, certainly, we only threw 3 people in. But he said, Nebuchadnezzar, look, I see 4 men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the 4th looks like a son of the gods. In other words, think about this. They're tied up by the strongest men in the army. And now they're walking freely. They couldn't have freed themselves, but they're walking around freely. And there's a 4th person in there that looks like a son of the gods. Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and the satraps, prefects, governors, and royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their head singed. Their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. Now, I like to grill, and if you've been to my small group, you know that, because we've grilled like 2 of the last 3 weeks. But I love to use charcoal. Now, here's the thing about grilling, especially with charcoal. If you are around charcoal, guess what you smell like? Charcoal, right? But so I grill and I smell like that fire until I take a shower. It's in my clothes, it's in my skin, it's everywhere. But these 3 men are thrown into this fire, and not only is their skin not harmed, and not only is their hair not scorched at all, they don't even smell like the fire that they were thrown into. This is nothing short of an absolute miracle that God provides. And I have to believe this is why these men are so confident in God, because they believe God can do anything. They trust him that he's bigger and better than any situation they face. They believe that he is more important, more powerful than the king of the most powerful, important kingdom of their day. They have confidence in God. But here's what I know about us. It's for us, we would struggle to have their confidence, right? If you were about to get thrown into a fire to your death, you probably wouldn't challenge them too much. And you might not believe that God's going to come through, but they have this confidence. So here's what we want to talk about just really quickly, is how do we cultivate that God confidence that Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 10 we need to cultivate? How do we have confidence like these men, to where we have a confidence in God that is not shaken by our circumstance? It's not shaken by the threats given to us. It's not shaken by how bad things get, but we can be confident in God regardless of our circumstances. I've got three things for you. They're all in your note sheet there. And the first thing is this, is that I can be confident in who God is. I can be confident in who God is. This summer, I'll have been married for 10 years. July 7th, 2007, we got married. Now, when we got married, we were 21 years old. A lot of people don't get married that young. I wouldn't advise it for everybody, but here's what I will tell you if you know people that are getting ready to get married and they are that young, is that you are going to make a million mistakes in your marriage. Especially if you're like me, okay? I have made so many mistakes, put my foot in my mouth more times than I could count, done things I wish in retrospect I wouldn't have done, said things I never should have even thought to say. I have been a terrible, terrible husband from time to time in our marriage, some from immaturity, and let's just be honest, plenty of it from stupidity, okay? But here's what I'll tell you. In a culture where marriage is increasingly devalued, I have never feared for my marriage before, in almost 10 years of being married. I've never had to worry about, is Katie going to change her mind about me because of this dumb thing I've done or terrible thing I've said? I've never had to worry about showing up and her stuff being gone. I've never had to stress about it. It's never entered into my mind. In fact, the word divorce has been banned from our marriage. We just don't talk about it. Now, I'm not saying that to judge those of you who have had those struggles. I just want you to know this. Do you know why I don't fear that in my marriage? It's because I know who my wife is. And I know my wife at the end of the day is better than me. I know that she's more patient than me. I know that she's wiser than me. I know that she's stronger than me. And I trust her completely. Because I know who she is, I can be confident in our relationship even when it's not going well. I think it's the same thing with God, guys. We can be confident in who God is because the way we see God shapes the way we see everything. In fact, A.W. Tozer, he's a great author, been dead a long time, but he's actually buried here in Akron. Here's what he said in his book, The Pursuit of God. He said, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." What comes into our minds when we think about God. So when you, first thing in the day or maybe later in your day, you think about God, what first comes into your mind is what's most important. Because if in your mind God is angry all the time, that's going to shape the way you see your life, right? But if you see God the way that he describes himself, it's going to change the way you see everything, right? So think about just what Jesus says about himself. He says he's the light of the world. Right? He tells us that because of him, we can be the salt of the earth. He says that he's a friend of sinners. In other words, he is a friend of people who mess up consistently. He loves us unconditionally. When I think about God, this wasn't always this way, but I can tell you right now when I think about God, I think of how much he loves me, how much he wants to have a relationship with me. I'm consumed by the fact that he wants to be with me and that he cares about everything that happens in my day. And here's what I'll tell you. That way of thinking about God has completely changed the way I see my relationship with God. I used to fear that God would send me to hell, even as a new Christian, even as a student pastor on staff at a church. I had this fear that I was only as good as my most recent mistake. But that's not the way God is. How we see God shapes the way we see everything. We can be confident in who God is because, let me tell you guys, God's not angry at you. And he's not disappointed in you. And he's not trying to stay away from you, but he wants to be close to you. Even when your life is all sorts of jacked up, he wants to be with you. We can be confident in who God is. But the second thing is this, I can be confident in what God has done. I can be confident in what God has done. So in other words, that's past tense. I can be confident in what God has done. There's something about the longer you have a relationship with God, the more built up in him your confidence can be, because what seems all-consuming today, you're going to look back 10 years from now and go, man, I can't believe God got me through that. And the longer you follow him, the more you're going to see that time after time, God just keeps coming through and keeps doing things that you would have at one point thought were impossible. And now it's almost like, I'll be honest, 13 years of following him, I'm expectant and I'm waiting to see what he's going to do. I'm not thinking, okay, God, will you help me out? I'm wondering, how is he going to help me and when is it going to come? I trust him all the time because I've seen what God has done. Now, for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they had heard the tradition passed down. They had read the scrolls. They knew about God, and they knew about everything he had done. They were familiar with his ways and familiar with his acts and with his miracles. This builds confidence in them to say, we believe that God can deliver us, and we believe that he will. Because guess what? They've heard time and time again, this is just what God does. God rescues his people. And for us, even if you don't have that much of a history with God, here's what I'll tell you. You have the scriptures at your disposal. Now, here's what's so great about that is the scriptures constantly ground themselves in history. Okay, in fact, there's only really one book in the Old Testament that we're not quite sure where to put it or how it fits into the timeline. That's the book of Job. But everything else when you read it, what you're going to notice is they're going to give you names, they're going to give you places, they're going to give you specific events, because the Bible, that's its like way of fact-checking itself. The original audience would have been encouraged, especially in the New Testament, when you read Paul writing these letters and he starts listing off all these names and you just want to skip it when you're reading your Bible. Here's why that's there. It's because he's saying, fact-check me. See if this checks out. See if this story really happened the way that I'm telling you it happened. The Bible's grounded in history, and so for us, we can read and we can build up our own confidence in what God has done, and it's going to show us what he can do. And here's the thing, God has done incredible things. In fact, even if you just were to read the book of John, there are eight miracles of John that can just build up your confidence, right? So here's what he does. First thing he does, he turns water into wine. If you're a partier, you love that one, right? Water into wine. He heals an official's son. He heals a man who's never been able to walk. He feeds 5,000 men, more likely at least 10,000 people, with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. He walks on water and allows Peter to walk on water. He gives sight to a man that was born blind. He raises Lazarus from the dead. And just to top it all off, because he likes to brag a little bit, he raises himself from the dead. Just in that one book, this one letter, there are things that if we believe them to be true, should absolutely shape your confidence in God. And here's what I'll tell you. We don't believe these things because we think maybe some of them happened. We have proof, documentation from Christians and non-Christians that Jesus rose from the dead. We can be confident, not just in who God is, but in what God has done. Which leads us to our third and final thing. I can be confident in what God will do. I can be confident in what God will do. Now, we talk a lot about faith, right, in churches, that we want to trust God. We have this confident belief in God. We don't talk as much about hope. And here's the thing about hope. Hope is an expectation that the future is going to be better. And here's what I'll tell you. As a Christian, when Paul writes that faith, hope, and love remain, he says that on purpose, that we as followers of Jesus Christ are meant to have a hope that believes that tomorrow is going to be better, that with Jesus, life just keeps getting better and better. And Jesus told his followers this when they were upset because he said, I'm going to die and I'm going to leave you. They were getting frazzled, but he was saying, no, guess what? It's just going to get better. And here's what he says in John 14. He says, very truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me, notice, you don't have to do a lot of great things. You just have to believe in him. Whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these because I'm going to the Father. He says, because I'm leaving, you're not just going to do what I've done. You're going to do greater things than I've done. You can be confident in what God is going to do through you, because for as great as the past is, and we can get confidence from that, what God wants to do in front of you and through you is even greater. We can be confident in what God will do because God is going to come through for you. I really believe that. I believe the struggle you're facing today, I believe God's going to come through. I believe that we can trust him, and I don't think that we have to have this incredible thing where we just state all this stuff and God's bound to do what we tell him to do. No, I just believe God loves us so much that he's going to help us. It might not be the way we want him to, but he's going to make things better. I really do believe that life with Jesus just gets better and better and better, and I think that has nothing to do with our circumstances. I believe God is bigger than what we're facing right now. In fact, in Psalm 46, the psalmist writes this. He says, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, so because of that, because he's with us in the midst of everything, therefore we will not fear. Though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of sea, though its waters roar and form and the mountains quake with raging. We do not have to fear, but we can have confidence because God is with us. He's our ever-present help in time of trouble. No matter how chaotic your life is getting, God's with us. Now, when you got that note sheet, I know some people read it and you laughed, but we titled this message, this talk, Suns Out, Guns Out, right? And we changed it, right? It's not sun as in like the sun you have coming out, because like it's getting warmer outside. You're going to see guys like me mowing the yard in my And I actually do have a Suns Out, Guns Out tank top because I like to embarrass my wife. I will wear those with my pasty white skin, and I'll wear some shorts that are too short and probably too tight because that's just how I roll, right? But here's the thing. You see that, and that whole phrase is this idea that, like, man, I'm confident in myself, right? Sun's out, so I'm taking my guns out. Here's the thing. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they have this incredible confidence in God, right? I mean, confidence that we would kill for. They just trust God in the face of circumstances that are so crazy. Probably none of us in here will face something like that. But they have confidence in the face of something even that tough and that bad. Now, here's what's so great about this, though. They're on the other side of what we know to be true. They have this confidence in God without the resurrection. They have this confidence in God fully based on just faith and hope, believing that God's going to enter into humanity, believing that God's going to send someone to save us, believing that God's going to make things right. But we're on the other side of this thing now, knowing that Jesus has come and he's already made it right. And he's coming again. And so guess what that means? Because he's out of the tomb, I can be confident in God. I don't have to blindly trust anything. He's out, man, so I can be confident. I can put on a show. I can believe in God like I would never believe would be possible because he's already done the impossible. Because he's out, I can be confident. They're on the other side. So how much more confident should we be than them? So here's my prayer for you. My prayer for you as we start this Mood Swinger series is that you would begin to trust God even more, and that trust in him would become confidence in him. And that when you go to work tomorrow or you go home today and something comes up, something unexpected, something bad, it wouldn't shake you, but you would remember, okay, God, I can be confident in who you are. This isn't happening because you're punishing me. I can be confident in what you've done. God, look at all the ways you've delivered other people. Why not me? You could deliver me in the exact same way. You could do something even greater I wouldn't expect, and I can be confident, God, in what you will do because I do believe that tomorrow is going to be a better day. My prayer is that God builds your confidence because that confidence is going to shape everyone around you.